Coming to you live, a rare episode of Crime Scene Time Machine, video version in the shadow of the Eglin Air Force Base and deep behind enemy lines. Today's episode is going to be very exciting. We're going to be hearing about different accounts of the UFO phenomenon, particularly involving orbs. We're going to be interviewing internationally acclaimed journalist Ross Coulthart about his insider information, about what he knows, about what evidence there is out there that could end the debate about the extraterrestrial reality tomorrow. We're going to be asking him other questions like, where is that UFO hidden in plain sight that's so big they had to build a building around it because they couldn't move it? We're going to ask Ross updates about his fight with Arrow and Dr. Fitzpatrick and the other debunkers and Project Blue Book style governmental agencies trying to stand in the way of the ultimate door stopper of the anomalous, the fearless Ross Coulthart, one of my best mates from around the world. And if I wasn't doing crime scene work, the only other job I would want is his, because he's got the coolest job around. So stick around for this week's episode of Crime Scene Time Machine, special on location in the belly of the beast video podcast from sunny Florida. This is Crime Scene Time Machine. I'm your host, Scott Roeder. I love you, planet Earth. You're going to love this episode, so stick around. Anyway, he was murdered in La Jolla, California, and his wife actually hired me to investigate it because the police ruled it a suicide. A lot of similarities with what we did on Nadine Hogg and that kind of an investigation. So we're going to be talking about that. But most importantly, I want to introduce my guest, the reigning champion of the Evidence Room episode, the episode that I had previously with Ross Coulthart, had over 100,000 downloads. The only guest I've ever had that broken anywhere close to that mark. Shows you the love the community has for this man, the teller of truths, the doorstopper of the anomalous, the man not afraid to pick at power. My friend, my good mate, all the way from the other side of the world, Ross Coulthart.
Oh, fuck off.
To the show.
How are you, buddy? Good to talk to you.
Great, man. Great to see you. You look fantastic. Like I was just telling you off camera, Ross is looking fit, looking beautiful. Those eyes, that face. I'm so happy to see you. You're a great friend.
I haven't been able to get up to Cleveland for a long time, and that's probably why my liver is feeling a lot healthier than it normally feels after I've been with you for a few days. So,
well, that's true. You know, in the spirit of the old St. Patrick's Day, I'm wearing the green, and I'm going to be headed back up to Cleveland to have a nice dance party with all my other fellow, you know, rebels and up there in Cleveland. But let's get to the reason why I've got this special guest here today. Ross, I've been investigating just on my own, casually, my little crime scene thing that I do, trying to apply my logic and reason in the crime scene world, which you kind of come from that too, and use that same methodology of logic and investigative, poking at the truth about orbs. I've been fascinated with orbs recently. My partner, Crystal, told me a story recently about orbs that she experienced as a child in her home. My friend Nolan Cavano, which you met, and one, my sound guy and also my web designer, and he's a great musician, he told me recently last summer about an orb over Lake Erie that flew out over Lake Erie, red, and right through his open window apartment, through his apartment, and then vanished through the door. I was reading recently about orbs and Matt Gaetz and information that may or may not have been disclosed about Eglin Air Force Base. And I needed to talk to you. I know you've been doing extensive investigation about, you know, these metal orbs and these plasma orbs and all this stuff. And I'm confused about it. I read the book by Chris Bledsoe, UFO of God. I was fascinated by it. I want your perspective, what you've learned, or what you think you know, or what the people who say they know tell you about the nature of orbs. And I'll hand it over to you.
Okay. So I think the orbs are part of the phenomenon. They're not man-made. They're not human-made. There's no evidence that I've seen that they're terrestrially manufactured. Certainly the people that I talk to suggest that they are NHI. I'm not sure that the metallic spheres that you're talking about are the same thing as the orbs, the plasma orbs. I just don't know. And I think we have to be careful about our classification, our taxonomy, if you like, because it may very well be we're talking about different things. But certainly, one of the best authorities on plasma orbs that I've ever read is ironically, the British Condigne Report, Condign, which was written by an official in British military intelligence, DI55 or something. I love the way the British have these fantastic acronyms for their secret services. And they hypothesized that pretty much the whole phenomena is plasma of some kind. And I don't buy that, but it was very interesting, the research that they'd done, because as part of building up that hypothesis, they did an enormous amount of work pulling together a lot of the sightings and very authoritative, in some cases, witness sightings from military officials, including in the former Soviet Union, of what seemed to be plasma orbs. And I guess all I can do is fall back, Scott, on what my sources tell me, and a journo is only ever as good as their sources. And so the speculation is that what these orbs are a technology which is being propelled by something equivalent to the Alcubierre drive, and that as part of that reaction, if you like, the energy that is created creates a purple-white haze around the object. And it's very interesting. If you look at a lot of UAP sightings, many, many times, more often than not, people describe that very same thing, a kind of a glow or a haze or a hue around an object of different intensities. But even the black triangular.
Do you think that's light spectrum, the phenomenon messing with the light spectrum?
Mate, I don't talk about what I don't get told for sure. I just don't know. I really don't know. But the scientists that I talk to say that it's a byproduct of the technology, that essentially whatever the technology is, let's call it anti-gravitics or some type of positive lift propulsion, or maybe it's a space-time metric drive which allows you to transition through different dimensions or different points in space-time by warping space-time. The theory, the hypothesis for such a thing to exist is there. I mean, Manuel Alcubierre hypothesized just such a drive well over 10, 15 years ago. But the energy that is needed to propel such a drive would be unimaginable for our human society. We are, we're an earthbound planet. And the hypothesis is that for you to be able to deploy the energy that would be necessary for such a craft, I think you've got to be a one-soul civilization. So you have to be able to control the kind of energy that is controlled by one sun, like, for example, our sun. And I find it fascinating because there are hints in science that we are potentially able to manipulate or enter or access what's called the quantum vacuum, and that you can essentially derive unlimited amounts of energy from the quantum vacuum. And maybe that's where they're getting their energy from. I just don't know. But what I do know is that the plasmas are probably the most frequent sighted object in the whole array of UAPs. And they do appear to be at times intelligently reacting to human witnesses, human experiences in around them. There are people here in Australia, a guy called Damien Knott, who I've spent a lot of time with, who seems to have this preternatural ability to attract them. And he photographs and videos them. And he can't explain what they are, but at different times he's seen structured craft behind them. But more often than not, all you see is a white glowing plasma. And maybe it's a form of stealth mode. I've got no idea. But let's not rule out the possibility. Maybe it's some kind of natural phenomenon. Maybe it's a form of life that we haven't yet discovered in our troposphere. There are actually stories from astronauts of weird orb-like objects that have been seen in orbit. And indeed, there's one particular account I'm fascinated by that involves astronauts describing almost snake-like organisms moving around the space shuttle. And we just don't know. But you know what I argue for, Scott? I argue for scientific investigation. We're well beyond now the period where, I mean, you're an evidence analyst. You know, you investigate solid evidence and you present criminal cases to courts. And I've had the pleasure of working with you with the evidence room on numerous occasions and telling really interesting stories with you. And what we often rely on is witness evidence.
Yeah.
And indeed, the criminal law embraces witness evidence. Certainly, we test witness evidence. We cross-examine witnesses. We measure whether we find those witnesses credible. But one of the things that is the most consistent threads in UAP reports is the consistency of orb sightings, spheres of some kind, glowing spheres that appear to react intelligently to human witnesses, that on occasion appear to have a technology behind them. And whether they're related to the metallic spheres, the steel metallic looking spheres that we see also in the literature, I just don't know. Certainly there have been accounts of such objects phasing up and then glowing, and indeed on occasion emitting some kind of a low resonance hum. All I know, my friend, is I want that technology, and so does the US, Russia, and China. And I suspect that's half the reason why this is all being kept secret, because there is this Cold War that my friend David Grush is referring to, that Russia and China and the US are all frantically competing to try and master whatever they've retrieved. And we're actually talking at quite an auspicious time right now, Scott, because we are talking on the evening before Friday, the 8th of March. It's already Friday, the 8th of March, where I am. But at 10 o'clock in the morning, Eastern time in Washington, it would appear that media who were given an embargoed copy of the Arrow, the Pentagon UFO investigation report, will be allowed to report for the first time the contents of what is the historical review of UAP sightings by the Pentagon's UFO investigation office. And don't get excited, because it's going to be a miserable maudlin whitewash. We're going to be told that there is no evidence of crash retrievals, that there is no evidence of NHI. And I suspect we'll push a line pushed by Dr. Sean Kirkpatrick, the former boss of Arrow in Scientific American recently, that there is no scientific evidence at all for all of these crazy claims, and that it's really just a bunch of people with tinfoil hats who've come up with these lunatic ideas. So, mate, I think we should really change the subject and start respectfully treating the Pentagon with the deference that it deserves, and we should move on and stop investigating this UAP issue, because it's clearly bullshit because the Pentagon says so.
I love your humor and the poignancy of what you said there. And you know, the thing that got me into the UFO phenomenon was my interest. Other than you, I was interested before, but my relationship with you really accelerated my interest. I'm like, if a guy like Ross is into it and was gobsmacked, I'm like, I got to get into this. This is such a great conundrum.
Sorry.
I know. Sorry. Thanks, bro.
Yeah, you know, many's the time, my friend, where I wish I wasn't down this rabbit hole, because it is so consuming. It is so absorbing. I've been up since very early this morning talking to the US, dealing with just a barrage of emails, messages, emails, and it's nonstop. It's absolutely nonstop. And I mean, I'm flattered. I'm really humbled that people trust me with information, but many is the time I wish I was just leading a more gentle life, bouncing my little dog on my knee and just enjoying life.
Yeah, I hear you, man. It, to me, and I've got a little grandbaby coming soon, so I'm really excited about bouncing my little grandbaby on my knee. I'm very excited to be a grandfather for the first time. And it gives me hope, right, for this new kind of earth that we can create through people like you, open-minded people that can change the consciousness. And I think you're right. You know, excuse my language, but, you know, the government's always going to lie to us, okay? You
Sure.
know, the government's going to tell you the same thing they told you about the Kennedy assassination. Nothing to see here, guys. Nothing.
You know, it's funny. I never quite believed you about the Kennedy assassination until I did the work. And as you know, I was involved in doing a story back in November on the, what is it, the 60th anniversary.
60th, yeah.
And there's kind of like that aha moment with the evidence in the JFK case where you just go, holy hell. Why in God's name do people not realize that this was a conspiracy? This wasn't just if anybody, if it was him at all, Lee Harvey Oswald. There was a whole group of people involved in that conspiracy to kill the president, and I'm just gobsmacked that you know, the evidence is there in plain sight, my friend, just like it is with the UFO story. And I think one of the things that worries me about your beautiful country, which I've been coming to now for 35, 40 years, is the degree of closed-mindedness at the moment. There's a reluctantness, there's a reluctance to actually engage intellectually with ideas, to actually think about the implications of things. And you know, I've got a horrible feeling we're sort of slow marching towards a war with China at the moment. And you know, when people talk about a winnable war with China, I just shake my head and think, what are they saying? They have no idea what they're talking about.
There's no
And it's
winning.
kind of the same with this
Right.
UAP issue, that there is a cognitive dissonance between what people like you and I know from quite thorough investigative research that makes us all go, well, this is an issue that needs to be taken seriously and scientifically engaged with. And frankly, I think you know, the reluctance and the truculent resistance by establishment science in the main to engage with this subject is depressing. And I think, you know, in 100 years' time, when we are aware of a non-human intelligence presence on this planet that's been around, I suspect, for thousands of years, I think we'll all shake our heads and go, this was our Galileo moment where, you know, there were a few speaking out saying that, yes, you know, science is wrong. Science is closing its mind. And more importantly, mainstream dogma. In the old days, of course, it was the Catholic Church, the Vatican, that was restraining Galileo from revealing that we did not live in an Earth-centered universe, that it was a heliocentric universe. And essentially, we have a sun in our solar system and we circle the sun. And for that heresy, he was basically, in the end, killed. And in this case, ironically, there is a secret that's being kept about the UAP mystery, which, you know, we're still investigating why that secret is being kept. But it's almost untenable now for people to suggest that there's not a reality there. You don't have to believe the whole this is aliens theme, but you can certainly believe that, as we started in this conversation, there are certainly plasmas, orbs of certain types, which are part of a whole series of phenomena which require investigation. And we should take those seriously because we're at a really interesting turning point in our history where we're no longer constrained by establishment media, establishment academia, even governments, because social media is a liberalizing force internationally. We can exchange ideas like we are here. And we don't have to allow ourselves to be subjected to the censorship or the rules or the strictures of establishment media or establishment thought. They can't stop us from having these conversations.
Not
And
yet,
that's
they
what I
can.
find fascinating. You and I can have these conversations. And as you say, there's a whole audience out there that's interested in engaging with it.
It really is, you know, in November 23rd, 1963, when that coup d'etat on the streets of an American, major American city, Dallas, Texas, in the middle of the day on camera, the leader of the free world, in my opinion, the last democratically elected president of the United States, John F. Kennedy, was killed for a whole host of reasons. One, his stance, his changing stance on wanting to be involved in war. Two, his interest in dealing with the Soviet Union to denuclearize the armament. Three, the UFO phenomenon was a very important, in my opinion, issue. Could be appearing. Marilyn Monroe was killed over the UFO phenomenon. The evidence
what we do know for an absolute certainty is that there was a concern from Kennedy about deconfliction involving UAPs, because not only was he being briefed about the fact that UAPs were being detected in the Arctic Circle region between Russia and the US, he was concerned, and so was his advisor, McNamara, that this might lead to an unintended nuclear exchange, because one side might fear that the other was attacking them because of these UAPs. And so, as Dave Grush pointed out to me in the interview that he did with me last year, there is actually a clause, incredibly, in the literature which refers to a treaty between the Soviet Union and the USA, which basically enshrines a responsibility to consult when UAPs are detected by either side. And that's fascinating, because at the same time that we've all been being told that these objects don't exist, that they're not real, and that all of this is a figment of our imagination, here are the Soviet Union at the time and the United States making agreements, international agreements, in law to discuss deconfliction because of a conflict that potentially could be caused by UAPs, unidentified anomalous phenomena. Now, that's important. And what I find interesting is the willful disregard for such evidence by a lot of people in mainstream academia and media. It's almost like people are frightened to engage. And what they don't realize is they're being played. There's a very deliberate disinformation operation underway, essentially to discourage people from taking this issue seriously. And we're seeing the beginning of that and what's unveiled on Friday, the 8th of March, by the Pentagon. They're going to essentially begin what is, I'm sure, an aggressive pushback against anybody that takes this issue seriously. And it's going to be a very interesting test for openness and transparency, both of the Congress and of all of us.
I want to talk to you about journalism. That's obviously your core. And I admire you as a journalist. I love journalism. Like I said, if I wasn't a crime scene expert, I'd want your job, right?
Because I have no money in it, mate. I romanticize it
because you are a fighter, man. But there's hope. Mainstream guys like you, you are a mainstream guy. You had more of a mainstream position before the UFO. Now you've kind of gone off on your own independently, kind of like Tucker Carlson did, you know, kind of like other mainstream journalists that now have their own news. Like Tucker Carlson is more reliable. People like him more than the entire Fox News generation or station. People depend upon what you do. You are a news agency in and of yourself. We don't need the establishment. And if more people took your lead and weren't afraid of throwing away how big their pile is or how many billboards their face is on, or, you know, how many times people say you win the journalism award. I understand that stuff doesn't mean anything to you. What means something to you is finding out the truth. I believe we need more journalists to Glenn Greenwald, same thing. He broke away. There's that whole phenomenon. A Substack is more read than the Washington Post and New York Times and all of the networks put together.
It's funny you should say that, actually, because journalism. I mean, I quite often on my own podcast, and I'm not boasting here, but I'm amused that, for example, Channel 7 put up an interview with me and Gary Nolan, Professor Gary Nolan from Stanford University.
Yeah.
Back in, I think it was late December, just before Christmas. And they rang me and they said, oh, we're putting up this interview with Gary Nolan. It might get a few hits over Christmas. And I mean, essentially all it was an opportunity for them to run a long form interview that I told them I thought the public might find very interesting. Oh my God. So within the first month, it was like 1.5 million. And now what is it? We're into March. It's well over 2.5, 2.6 million people have looked at that one interview of me questioning Gary Nolan. And what it shows is, and that's a rating, frankly, CBS 60 Minutes, PBS Frontline, you know, all of the big shows, 2020, I don't even know if 2020 is still going, but, you know, all of the big shows, they can only dream of ratings like that. And what's interesting is we still attach an enormous amount of significance to what the legacy mainstream media says about things. And I can tell you, I'm somebody from that world. I think it's dead. The really exciting thing about where I'm working at the moment with News Nation is, you know, they're allowing me a presence with a new show on YouTube, with a show that I've created called Reality Check. And most of the time we're going to be online, but we're also going to have a show at times when it's warranted on the main program. But I fully expect and hope that what we put up on YouTube will outrate what they put up on their cable TV network. And that's not to be mischievous. It's just to say that what's interesting is that there is a huge audience out there that are picking and choosing the media they want to hear. And just because the mainstream masthead media is not covering the issue of UAPs, there's no point in getting upset about it. It would help if they did, because then the White House might pull its finger out of certain orifices and start doing something about it. But the simple fact is, people are highly motivated about this issue in a way that I've never seen before. I am overwhelmed with interest from people. I could sit at my desk for another 10 years and still not get on top of the 40,000 emails that I've got sitting in my inbox.
And that's why I'm so grateful that you answer my call, I feel.
When Scott Roeder asks, he gets. I have to say there's a conga line of podcasters who are pleading with me to do podcast interviews with them. And I've been telling them I just don't have any time. And I couldn't say no to you, mate, because I'm going to bludge something off you later that I want to talk to you about.
Oh, yeah.
I think we should do I think you and I should do a few projects on Reality Check.
Up to.
So let's have a talk about that off camera.
Absolutely. I want to put something to you, because and this may not just be about the UFO phenomenon, but this is just two human beings taking our world of experience and putting a check on something. And I want to put to you this concept. I think it all starts with Kennedy, or World War II, and then John F. Kennedy, and after he was assassinated, because what the UFO phenomenon, I feel the technology behind it from that time, right, has only been used for probably war, right, or preparing for war. But if we as a society stopped, if we utilized this technology for good, and Nikola Tesla's free energy system for good, and Thomson Brown's anti-gravitic energy for good.
Oh, Thomas TTB, Thomas Tanzian Brown, yeah.
Thank you, yeah. All that technology since the time of J.P. Morgan has been bought and buried and will never be out for people like us, because they...
Okay, so you're inviting me to enter into that conspiracy theory, which still is. I don't know for sure that that's true.
Well,
I have a suspicion that it might be. Certainly, I'm aware of scientists who claim that they have developed over unity devices, essentially free energy devices, more energy out than in. And I've seen the scientific data for those devices. And I mean, ultimately, I would never make an express opinion one way or the other until I've actually seen it demonstrated and seen it maybe running a spacecraft. You know, wouldn't it be lovely? Let's build an Alcubierre drive, Scott, and fly to Jupiter. I did say to somebody the other day, I said, look, I'm quite corruptible. This is somebody...
That's what I like about you.
I said to somebody in the legacy program, I said, no, money's not going to break me. But I said, if somebody was to offer me a flight, maybe around the solar system, in one of the TR-3Bs they've got hidden in the back of Groom Lake, I'd be there with bells on, and I'd promise to shut up for the rest of my life. I'll just quietly go into my retirement.
You have to tell a few people.
Mouth shut.
But I guess my point is scarcity of resources. I believe, and this is maybe not a conspiracy theory, but a hypothesis, let's just say. I'm not saying any of this is true, but knowing human nature, I have a hypothesis that there is a false nature of the scarcity of resources. The UFO phenomenon and other free energy things would take away the scarcity of resources, which then destroys the oligarchy class of the world, because we don't need oil and coal and all those things. We could have all of it. And That's why we have wars, for fake scarcity of resources. And the UFO phenomenon, in my opinion, represents a portion of the hidden technology that could be used for peaceful, free energy for the world, but is deliberately being withheld purposes of full spectrum dominance. Just my opinion. I put that to you. Is that crazy to think that?
It's not crazy to suspect that, no. I'm reserving my definitive opinion one way or the other. I think I won't believe that the US has this technology until I see it for myself. I've spoken to people who tell me that they've seen it. I've spoken to people who tell me that they are in possession of the capacity to derive low-energy nuclear reactions, cold fusion, if you like.
Yeah.
I'm perplexed, if that's the case, as to why they're keeping it secret. And, you know, we have a saying in my line of work, which is probably pretty vulgar, so always assume a screw-up before a conspiracy. And, you know, normally we say something slightly more vulgar. But the simple fact is conspiracies very rarely happen. But in this case, I do think that there's a body of evidence to suggest that there is a conspiracy and that we should be skeptical about the assurances being given by our government. And so that's why I'm particularly concerned that what's being unveiled on Friday, the 8th of March, is an attempt by the Pentagon to put all of this back in a box. It's trying to constrain the narrative and control what the public gets to hear. And I don't think it's a coincidence either that terminology like the Office of Global Access of the CIA, which is the body that I'm told largely controls this whole operation, the OGA is slowly disappearing from websites and any mentions on Google search, even though it was prominently featured in reports by both the Daily Mail and my good friend Christopher Sharp in the Liberation Times. And that happens a lot. Somebody's tinkering with the algorithms that control online what you and I get to hear. But the lovely thing about these algorithms is they also pander to what people want to know. And I think that's why UAPs very much are the issue du jour. And even though you won't read about them in the New York Times or the Washington Post, the world of social media is full of the subject because there's a thing called the wisdom of the crowd, Scott. It's essentially when the crowd know more than that individual expert up on the stage. They can see when a politician sucks, when he's really on his last legs. And it's the crowd that can perceive that. And in this case, there's a crowd basically saying that the UAP is real. You know, there is a phenomenon that is real. It requires proper scientific investigation, empirical measurement. And sooner or later, the government will be dragged kicking and screaming into an admission about what it knows.
Yeah, I would only add on that the algorithm should really tell people what they need to know, which is the name of your other podcast, Need to Know, with Ross Coulthart and your partner. What's your partner? Bryce Zabel, that's right. He a filmmaker, producer, made a lot of great stuff. He did a post, I don't know if it was a book or a show about post-disclosure.
After Disclosure, it's an excellent book that he wrote with Richard Dolan, a terrific book.
Have you met Richard Dolan? Yeah. Do you know him personally?
Yes, I have, actually, yeah. Richard
and Tracy. He is nice, I hope he is.
Good people, very nice guy, very nice guy.
I really love his work. I hold you and him in similar capacities because.
Oh, no, look, I'm awestruck by the work, the scholarship that Richard's done. I mean, you know, he attempted long before it became fashionable academic scholarship on the UAP issue, and the work that he's done to piece together from public sources and from private sources UAP stories. I mean, you've only got to read his book, UFOs and the National Security State, which I think is now in two volumes, and to realize that, you know, there's a reality there. There's a there.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm probably not giving anything away if I say that Richard's working on a book at the moment about USOs, underwater, unidentified submerged objects. Yes. I think that's what it is. But, Yeah, that's coming out, I think, in the fall.
Yeah, I'm excited about that. I want to get a couple things because I have a request. I told my friend who has a podcast called Extraterrestrial Reality. His name is Jim Quirk. He's a big fan of yours. He quotes your work all the time on his show. And he had a couple of questions he wanted me to relay to you to see if you, and I said, there's no way he's going to answer these, Jim, but I'll ask. Okay. So, if you can answer them, but I understand some things you can't say. He says, please ask Mr. Coulthart about the location of the giant UFO that they constructed a building over it. Also, ask him if he's aware of any other end-all evidence in the possession of a whistleblower currently that you know about that, if revealed, could end the debate about extraterrestrial reality tomorrow. Two-parter.
Let's do the last one first.
Yeah, of course.
Yes, I do. I'm talking to legacy program witnesses. But if you were somebody working within the military-industrial complex and you saw the way that Dr. Sean Kirkpatrick disgracefully ridicules with contempt and lack of any scientific rigor the investigation of UAPs and the way that the Pentagon is colluding improperly, quite disgracefully and probably unconstitutionally in misleading the public about the issue, I think a lot of whistleblowers are sitting there thinking, well, what's in it for me to come forward? I'm just going to get screwed. And I mean, sadly, whistleblowers do often get screwed. They get shafted by the very institutions that they're blowing the whistle on. Now, that's why the Schumer Amendment, these laws that were proposed to go before the Congress, were so important. Some of those laws got through. But very important provisions that would have done more to protect whistleblowers were deliberately excluded from
being made into law. By the Ohio, my senator or my congressman from Ohio, from Dayton, Ohio, he was the one that blocked
Turner.
Mike Turner, because he gets all that money from Wright Patterson and the military industrial complex down there in Dayton, Ohio, at Wright Patterson Air Force Base, which is where it is suggested by the people who say they know. Is where the Roswell UFO crash was taken, or the extraterrestrial biological entity EB1, according to other people that I've heard say that they know, was taken down there and housed. Now, we only have 2.5 minutes left, so I wanted to get just a couple more questions that put to you, and that is...
Oh, sorry, I need to answer the big UFO question.
Oh, yeah, the big one. Yeah. I knew you were going to not answer it, but go ahead.
I've answered this several times, and people get very aggressive. In fact, I've actually had, it's quite serious, I've had people threatening me with violence and indeed, in one case, death for not revealing it. And there's an attitude amongst the UAP world that I should just blurt it out. I'm not going to tell you.
I knew it. Well, is it because
as I've explained multiple times, and people don't want to hear this, one of the things that I am is a patriot. I respect national security. I'm not one of those journalists that believes that you should just recklessly disclose the location of something that is national security sensitive, especially not when it's in a particularly sensitive area. And
would it put people's lives in danger, Ross? I'm asking you to do it, but if it came out, not by you necessarily, but if somebody found out and leaked it and people are like, holy shit, how do we not see that? Would it literally put people's lives in danger?
Yeah, it would.
If people found out, really?
Yeah, I really do think it would.
Okay.
And I think, it could be quite dangerous. And look, you know, you and I are part, as our nations are, of the Yakuza Alliance, the Five Eyes. Yep. And since the end of the Second World War, for right or for wrong, we've been allies through thick and thin in wars that sometimes are of questionable morality and importance. But nonetheless, we've looked out for each other. We're mates, as we say in Australia. And even though I'm not a US citizen, I do recognize the importance of heeding national security laws in the United States. And I'm always very careful when I talk to people that, if I'm soliciting information, I'm saying, look, I don't want sensitive, top secret SCI compartmentalized documents. I don't want to be put in the position of receiving information that could essentially see me in jail, or worse still, see me inadvertently compromising an important US intelligence operation. And that's part of the problem here, is that I suspect that the people in these agencies, although I violently disagree with them, I think they take the view it's a huge place.
Yeah, no, it's a nice big. This is just my Florida room. It's a 30 by 30 Florida room, and then we've got 3,000 square feet, and we're right on the ocean. I've been taking my dog in the ocean. One thing I got to tell you, the ocean over here is the Gulf of Mexico, okay? And Destin is considered the luckiest fishing town in the world. I was out on the boat the other day. I don't even have my Florida fishing license downloaded on my phone yet, my visitor's license. I put a live shrimp on the hook, throw it out. Before I even have the fishing license downloaded, I'm pulling out a 3-foot hammerhead shark. Just wow. Like, I must have picked 20 fish out of the water with a small bucket of live shrimp and just a bobber and a hook and a weight, you know, just like little 20-yard cast.
Gorgeous.
Oh my God.
Lovely.
Fantastic. Yeah, my skin's going to be as golden as yours pretty soon.
So just tell me, what was I talking about? I've forgotten.
Well, you were talking about although you're not an American, you respect the sanctity of journalism and not putting people at risk.
Sure. A lot of people get the mistaken idea that what journalists have to do is just in an anarchic way release information, a bit like WikiLeaks, and just put it up there and not care about the consequences. And I'm legally obliged to make sure that I don't breach national security laws. None of us have any desire to end up like poor old Julian Assange in Belmarsh prison in the United Kingdom, awaiting extradition to the United States for, sadly, recklessly procuring US national security secrets and putting them up online. No, the simple fact is that you don't need to do that. I mean, there's no need to reveal sensitive technologies that could potentially be quite dangerous, because what you shouldn't forget is that if it is true, let's say if it's true that these technologies exist, then there's also the potential for the energy systems, the propulsion systems. If for example, we've got anti-gravitics, those propulsion systems could also be deployed as a weapon. You know, you could flatten a city. You could eradicate an area of landscape. I mean, the potential for them is horrifying. And sadly, we are still primitive apes. We kill each other. There's actually a trench war going on in Ukraine right now. It's just unbelievable to me that 100 and something years on from the end of the First World War, humans are still killing each other in mortal combat, in, you know, close hand-to-hand combat. It's barbaric. And if I was an alien civilization looking on at us, I'd be quite despondent and thinking, gee, should these guys be trusted with the crown jewels, with the incredible scientific knowledge that we're here to give them? I'd be very skeptical. But yeah. I guess my hope is, mate, and just to come to the point that I think you were making earlier, my hope is that if we began thinking of ourselves as humans rather than as Russians or as Chinese or as Americans or as Australians, if the awareness of being not alone suddenly hit the human race, I think that would have profound effects on our thoughts of ourselves as human beings. And I'm often reminded of that quote that President Reagan said back in the days when he was meeting with Gorbachev, President Gorbachev of the Soviet Union, before the end of the period of Soviet Union tyranny. And Reagan speculated that, you know, if indeed, you know, we were faced by a mortal peril from outside humanity, say that we were threatened by an intelligence far greater than ours, that had greater technology than ours, he asked Gorbachev, what would you do? And of course, Gorbachev said, I would come to your aid. And that's something that we all have to remember, is that the moment that we become aware of ourselves as human beings, not as individual nationalities, I think is the moment that we become truly human. And maybe that's the transition point. Maybe that's the inflection point that we have to get to before we can become trusted with these technologies. But I'm pretty certain they exist.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to harken back to a couple of people and comments that I'll put to you just to, from my perspective on it. And one is, there's no bad armies. There's only bad generals. And I feel that it's those select generals, not only on the battlefield, but in the in society, those leaders that infect everyone else to be warlike. And you know, I think even one of the head Nazis at the Nuremberg trials was asked, how did you get the German people to do these horrible things during World War II? And he said something to the effect at his own tribunal that nobody wants to fight. You have to lie to the people to get them to go to war, because I don't think humans, our natural state is warlike and greedy and making our power big. I believe the real true humanity is like the original human economy, which was an economy of gratitude. And I had a podcast I just put out the other day called War or Pancakes. And it's just a simple example. Like, if I'm not a crime scene guy, let's just say I pick something I do good. I make really good pancakes, banana pancakes, bacon pancakes, all different kinds of pancakes, make them hot off the griddle and serve them up. And if I give that pancake to somebody, and let's say that guy knows how to build a wood deck, and I give him free pancakes, he builds me a wood deck so that I can invite people over to eat more pancakes, to give more gratitude. And then it's that old barter system. I think that's the true humanity, where we become in service to each other for the benefit of the whole. And that's where I want us. And that's where I feel like that's where your heart is. That's where my heart is.
I'm sure there's a few people listening to this going, that sounds like communism. It sounds like socialism, Scott. My God.
I don't mean it that
way. You're a socialist.
No, I'm an American, man. I'm American. And I know you said you're not an American, but you are one of my best mates. And dadgummit, you are more filled with the American spirit than most of our elected leaders. And we would be damn happy to have you as an American citizen. Or
well, it's funny. It's funny that you're living in Florida. I love the fact that you're now living in Florida, because the thing I love, the most emblematic symbol to me of American exceptionalism, is the space race, is the fact that in the early 1960s, President Kennedy committed to winning the space race against the Russians, against the Soviet Union. And it helped, I'm told now in the official histories, to bankrupt the Soviets and bring their quite evil empire to the end. Yeah. And the tragedy is that we didn't learn from the mistakes that we'd made during the Cold War, and we've probably exacerbated things with Putin since. But the, you know, there was a great moment in American history that's just down the road from you, you know, where essentially America committed to a scientific idea of exploration, of taking a risk, of stepping out into the unknown. And that's what we're faced with the UAP issue, whether we like it or not. It's real. The U.S. has formally admitted that whatever it is, it's real. It's a genuine, authentic mystery. And for that reason, I think we should embrace the adventure and go into the beyond.
Yeah, I agree with you. I'm all about adventure. I am an adventurer at heart. I love taking on projects that I don't know anything about and just figuring it out as I go, and being the curious, childlike investigator that I hope to be judged at the end of the day. I just want people to say, hey, he was curious. He did a good job. And he put himself out there and tried to like learn something and not be afraid to learn and not be afraid to fail. Now, I've got one more quick question before we wrap this thing up.
I do have to go pretty soon, my friend. Yeah.
But this is my last question. I did a podcast about 8 podcasts ago on the Crime Scene Time Machine where I said, the name of it was Not Everybody Knows Everything. And it was a criticism and a breakdown of an interview that Neil deGrasse Tyson had with Kurt Jaimungal. Okay, you know, you were on his show. And it was a great interview where Kurt Zeitmungo, in my opinion, exposed Neil deGrasse Tyson's lack of curiosity in the true scientific method. And recently, and matter of fact, it might even have been in your interview with Dr. Nolan, where Dr. Gary Nolan said, Neil deGrasse Tyson's PhD should be stripped from him because of his absolute, inexplicable, unscientific behavior. What do you say?
Look, I'm not into, I mean, I don't love it, despite what some people have tried to say. You know, it's funny, the other day actually it was over a year ago now, I said that people who were covering the secret up should be tarred and feathered and driven around Washington, D.C. behind a Humvee. And what I was actually doing was paying an allegorical homage to Hunter S. Thompson, but clearly the literary allusions were completely lost on the idiots that saw that as an exhortation by me to commit violence. Yeah, I'm not advocating violence, and frankly, I don't like the bullying that takes place in the subject matter of UAPs. There's a lot of people lording it over one another and shafting each other, and frankly, I think we're all committed to the same cause. We're all committed to trying to get to the truth. It's all I want.
I know that's all you want, but is that all what debunkers, in my opinion, like Neil deGrasse Tyson, Michael Shermer, and Dr. Fitzpatrick, these people get in the way of the curiosity of the truth, and they just want to say, you're not smart enough to get it, nothing to see here, leave it to the experts. I don't agree with that philosophy.
Well, one thing that I often say is, mainstream science doesn't own science. It doesn't own the scientific hypothesis. You know, we have a system, a way of measuring and assessing empirical data. And it's a really clever way. It's the best one we've got. It's to form a hypothesis, to test that hypothesis by applying evidence, and then reaching a conclusion based on that evidence as to whether the hypothesis fits, and then adjusting that hypothesis.
Sorry, that was my computer telling me.
All right, no worries.
And I know we have to go. Where can people find your work, your books? What do you have coming up? I want everybody in my community, because I know I'm going to get a ton of downloads, and you deserve every book sale, everything that you get, because your work is fantastic. Please tell the audience where they can find you and what's coming up for you.
You can read my book, In Plain Sight, available at all good bookshops. You can watch the podcast I do with my friend and colleague, Bryce Zabel, Need to Know, and that's at www.needtoknow.com. It's also on YouTube. You can also watch a new show of mine that's starting up on News Nation, where I work as a special correspondent. It'll be on YouTube. It's called Reality Check. It'll be under the News Nation banner. And what we're going to be doing is investigating things. At the moment, I'm investigating the MH370 mystery, the mystery of the Malaysian jet that went missing literally 10 years ago today in Australia.
Love that story.
It's a horrible story, but well, it's a fascinating story. Because
it's so deep, though. There's so much to it.
Absolutely. So that's what else I'm doing. I'm doing the show called Reality Check, and if people want to see any of my previous UAP work, they can Google me or just run me on YouTube. There's plenty of copies of the News Nation interview I did with David Grush last year for News Nation. There's also the Channel 7 Australia Spotlight channel on YouTube, which has two of my UFO documentaries, which I've done previously.
Got a couple of shows that we did together on there too, I think.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And you can watch me on News Nation. You can watch me on Need to Know, and you'll also soon be able to watch me on a new show called Reality Check.
Reality Check. Maybe yours truly might be participating in some nominal way if I'm so lucky.
I'd like to see you there, brother. I'd be honored.
On behalf of everybody here at the Crime Scene Time Machine Nation, you're my mate. I love you. Thank you for being here. And like my big sign off, I want to tell everybody, I love you, Planet Earth. Just the way you are.
Hey, have you got a spare room in your Florida house? I might come and bludge a night off you one night.
Absolutely, man. I'll take you out on the boat. We'll pull some sharks.
I'd love
out
to.
The water.
Yeah. So what town are you in?
I'm in Destin, Florida. It's right in between.
D-E-S-T-I-N? How do you spell it?
D-E-S-T-I-N, yeah.
And it's right next to Eglin Air Force Base.
Right into the shadow of it. During the day, I hear the drone of the all the heavy machinery. And at night, they do practice bombing runs. So sometimes I wake up at 3 a.m. to like the bombs and vibrating of the ground. It's literally 10 miles away. It's literally, I think it's the biggest, most active Air Force bases. Matter of fact, this is the Air Force base that Matt Goetz said he saw evidence of 4 UFOs. And there's reports that back in 1972, they tried to bring in heavy equipment to pierce the shell 15 minutes with a giant diamond-tipped pierced drill. Couldn't even scratch it. All kinds of great stuff. Maybe we can get into that to another time. But I know you guys.
Well, look, I mean, it's funny. I mean, you should have a look at the Black Vault website.
Yeah.
Because they've just published a very interesting document that was obtained on FOI, which shows that there is a video that the US Air Force is holding back. And it appears to be the incident that Matt Goetz was told about in Florida last year. And it's essentially a US Air Force pilot describing how he rolled his gun camera and took vision of an object that looked like a giant acorn, looked like an Apollo spacecraft, hovering in the air just off the coast of Florida.
Wow.
And what I find amazing is that that's been declassified at exactly the same time that the Pentagon is pushing this nonsense that there's nothing to this whole UAP issue. It's quite breathtaking.
Is Aero just Blue Book all over again?
Yeah, it's Condon 2.0.
Yeah.
My friend, I've got to go. I've got a million and one things I've got to do.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you for being on the show. I love you, mate.
Good on you. Love you back.
See you later. Take care.
See you, mate. Cheers. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Hey, we'll talk again, Scott. I'm a bit busy today, but we'll talk again.
Hit me up anytime.
Okay, mate. All the best.
Bye. Well, that's all we have for you on this episode of Crime Scene Time Machine. That was a wonderful interview with my good mate, Ross Coulthart. And we're going to be hearing a little bit more about Ross. And hopefully you'll be hearing about his new show, Reality Check, on News Nation. And maybe even I'll be on that doing some investigation on a couple of other real fun stuff. So I want to give a big thanks to Ross. He was so gracious with his time. And answering our questions and really giving us something to think about and having a little bit of a morality, you know, to the journalism game that he's got. And I respect that. I feel honored to call him my friend. So for everybody here at the Crime Scene Time Machine, on behalf of Ross Coulthart and my family and all my loved ones, I want you guys to have a great rest of your day out there. And remember, I love you, planet Earth. I love everybody on it. Let's just spread a little bit more love out there. We'll be all right. And be curious. It's good for you. We'll see you next time. Bye.